There have been several writings of the settlement now called Rumford, starting with that of Reverend Daniel Gould, William Lapham, Jack Lane, Randy Bennett, Peter McKenna, Alfred Howard, Dr. Joseph Edward Martin, and Stuart Martin, with his genealogy of Nupinacook folks. Each author had a mission or a reason for their writings. These varied from purely a diary recording, their family history, recording happenings of the town, to a scholar style which interpreted the previous works of others. However, few of these historians have done as much research into our ancestry as Stuart Martin of Rumford Point. Stuart, with grassroots dating with Rumford's beginning, having one grandfather a veteran in the Civil War, another a country doctor, and a father who was a town official. Farmer and country storekeeper, his interest in local history was much more than idle curiosity. His wife, the former Estella Kimball, also the descendant of an early settler, played an enormous part in his historical research and writings. A daughter, Anne, and a son, Kimball, now school teachers, were always available for support and advice. Stuart has always lived at the Point and been a leader in the community, town, county, and state government. A school board member, selectman, Rumford town manager, Oxford County treasurer, the commissioner, Stuart retired from political life as the Mexico town manager. Of course, we always will remember Stuart as a country auctioneer. Since his retirement, Stuart has dedicated his life to leaving a legacy for others to enjoy, the heritage of Nupinacook Valley, known as Rumford. He has been instrumental in collecting, cataloging, and displaying archives in the Rumford Historical Society. These items are on display in the municipal building and also in the museum he helped develop, located in the Lufkin School at Rumford Center. I'm Bud Burns, Senior Project Engineer at Boise Cascade. Boise Cascade and its many employees over the years are part of this heritage and are proud of these roots. Stuart has invited us into his home to share with us some of the many pictures of people and places with some interesting facts. Boise Cascade is honored to accept this invitation to record and make available this visit with Stuart Martin and a portion of Rumford's history for all to enjoy. Please join us in Stuart's living room to view these interesting pictures of then and now and hear how our town developed.
Rumford had a very unusual beginning. Like many towns, they're named for certain situations or purposes. Rumford was named, in quote, for the sufferers who conquered. And no other place in history can you find a situation of that kind. And you have to go back, way back in the history of Concord in order to understand the history of Rumford and Rumford's beginning. The Walker family moved into what is now Concord. Previous to that time was Rumford, and previous to that time was Nupinacook, a little settlement on the Merrimack River where the Reverend Timothy Walker came from Woburn, settled down with a flock, and started a little colony, and there is the garrison that he built somewhere in the early 1700s. From there, the village grew. The garrison was necessary because the Indians were frequent in the area and there were Indian raids, there were killings and scalpings. And they had a garrison where they could, all of the people could go, although probably most of the Walker family were the only ones that lived in the garrison. But as the place grew, it changed, and eventually it became recognized by the Commonwealth of Massachusetts as as Penacook Plantation. Then later on, they wanted to organize the government in a more perfect manner, and in connection with the laws of the state at that time, it became Rumford. And Rumford was taken from a little village, a hamlet, a borough, I guess you'd call it, outside of London, where many of the earliest settlers of that region came from when they came to this country. Early historians have missed a lot of points because there's a lot of material come up by 20th century historians with regard to the naming of the towns, and especially the town we live in here, Rumford in Maine. I want to read you a little excerpt from a book that was published by a man by the name of Leon Anderson, who was the official historian for the New Hampshire legislature, and was a historical reporter for the Concord Monitor, one of the largest newspapers in New Hampshire. What happened, they got into a great dispute between New Hampshire and Massachusetts over the state lines. And it's so complex that it would take days and days of recording to fully explain the situation. But eventually there had to come a settlement. And the court settled in favor of the state of New Hampshire. And the people that really had settled in what they thought was a part of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts found that they were in New Hampshire and that other people in New Hampshire had settled on the same lands. And therefore, there was deep trouble. And the people of the Walker clan found out that they'd been deprived of their lands. It was then that Reverend Timothy Walker made his third trip to England in order to get the matter straightened out, because the King of England was the only one that could settle disputes of this kind. The General Court of Massachusetts could settle some disputes, but only the King could rule in such matters as this. And so they gave, eventually they set off this land that we live in now, 7 miles square, to the sufferers, so-called. You see, in 1635, in the consequence of settling the dispute, the name Rumford got lost, and they called it Concord. And the people, the Walker people, were terribly upset because they had lost the name that they'd cherished. Right. Now, in the meantime, the Reverend Walker had passed away, but his son Timothy, who had acquired the title of Colonel Walker, had followed it as the patriarch of the area, and he was responsible in part for the granting of this 7 miles square. We have to make that differential, not 7 square miles. And I want to read you from this historical mini history of Anderson's of the history of Concord, because there's no question Concord is the parent town of Rumford, Maine. In the meantime, the settlers that had come here had chosen the name New Pennacook Plantation in remembrance of the old Pennacook in New Hampshire. And after the government was being formed here by the early settlers under the name of New Pennacook, they were looking forward to it becoming a town also. And the people that were petitioning the General Court of Massachusetts for the name of China. For some reason, a lot of historians believe because at that time the ships out of Portland were plying a China trade. And Portland was called, of course, Falmouth at that time, and it was popular to name towns, new towns for old countries. But here is written, in 1799, as New Pennacook prospered, its citizens petitioned the legislature of Boston for a name change to China. This sent Judge Walker, by then a jurist and frequent but unsuccessful candidate for governor, to Boston once again. Because of his political status, he was well liked by these Bay State legislative circles, and when he urged that New Pennacook be changed to Rumford rather than China, his proposal was accepted. On February 21st, 1800, the plantation of New Pennacook became the town of Rumford. And here is the important part: in memory of the name which Concord lost in 1765, and it has remained so to this day. So the theory of the town being named for Count Rumford is seriously challenged by this piece of history. And in fact, very few historians have actually come out and said emphatically that it was named. They've questioned whether it was not named for Benjamin Thompson. Well, we get to deal a little bit with Benjamin Thompson at this point, because he'd come into Concord as a young man and a school teacher, solicited by the Reverend Walker, who was the patriarch of the town at the time. Walker's daughter had married an elderly, wealthy man who had recently died, and by the time Benjamin Thompson had been there a year or so, he married Walker's daughter, who was really one of the wealthiest people in town.
The one who was widowed.
That's right, the widowed daughter. Well, he became, the Revolutionary War was steaming up, and he became disassociated with the Patriots and favoring the British, and he got in good with General Gage, who was the English officer in charge of Boston at the time. And eventually, to make a long story short, eventually he deserted. He deserted his wife and child that had appeared recently on the scene, and went to England. And there, of course, he became famous in his research, in his scientific experiments, and he was also in Bavaria, and that's where he was received the title of count, and he chose Rumford. Now, the later historians assert that it was his respect for his father-in-law, The Reverend Timothy Walker. It is his respect for him and his knowledge that Walker was terribly upset when the name of Rumford was lost, that he chose name Rumford. And we could go in depth to the theories and so forth of the naming of the town and why it was or wasn't named for Count Rumford. One of the authors, a man by the name of Sanborn Brown, who was a doctorate and a professor at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, had written some things. And I'd like to read you a little bit out of his book. And he goes and quote, "There's nothing about being a scientist, an engineer, or a sociologist that excuses immoral behavior. And the result of Rumford's antisocial attitudes was to cut him off from the very fame he sought. People who tried to live and work with him found it so difficult to give him credit for his real achievement that when his life was over, they just forgot him as fast as possible." Another historian who had searched, and this is an interesting thing, most of these historians who searched Thompson's life were early American historians. A man by the name of Shepherd, I have this here, Sparrow, Shepherd was another officer. Sparrow dug into the British military records, and he found out that Thompson, who later became Count Rumford, turned as a British spy, and he found the copies of the spy letters in the British military records in England. And copies of the letters are published in his book. Now, Sparrow was a very learned gentleman. In fact, he was a professor of history at the University of Birmingham in England. And a few quotes from his book said he deserted his country and given comfort to the enemy, feeling which had run high before he left and was bitter now. In New England, there was blind hatred for loyalists of paler hues than Thompson. Again, he writes, "While contemplating his character, we do not stop to inquire the motives which induced him to abandon his country." And it goes on and on. And so we have to consider that it was Colonel Walker, Judge Walker, that really had the credit for naming this place we live in as the town of Rumford. So we're back to the time they came here. The awarding of the rights to the lands, the drawing of the lots, and the coming of the people. They got here first, of course. The Walker family was here a little later, but the first settler, of course, was Jonathan Kies, and he died before Rumford ever became a town. It was still a new Pennacook plantation. He'd brought his two sons here, Francis and Ebenezer. Ebenezer went on to Jay, and he was the founder of the town of Jay. Francis Kies became the leader of that era. He was here by 1778 or 9, before the last Indian raid on Bethel. The coming of the people is an interesting situation. The first group that came in here, as shown up in the 1790 census, had 18 families and of consisting of 74 people. There were only 13 of those 74 under the age of 16. But 10 years later, after they start coming in, the young people started coming, the younger families. There were 44 families at that time with 262 people, and only 10 of those 262 were over 45 years of age. And so it was the young people that were coming here and settling and farming the town. In that census, too, there were 123 children under the age of 10 out of that 262. So it was the young people that left Concord to come here to settle in the new lands. And they settled. Here is a photograph of an early photograph of a log cabin and then a board building after. This happened to be up near Poplar Hill in Mexico, but someone preserved it. The log cabins were the things they lived in until the sawmills got going. And so we get into this era, and so we have to talk about what were the people having to deal with. Of course, they needed the first thing were food, and the schools and the churches and so forth. But in the schools, and we went to the farming business, and they had to clear the lands. The stumps were pulled, and the virgin forests were almost a matter of waste. In fact, in Francis Kai's writings, some of which fell into the lap of Dr. William Lapham when he wrote Lapham's History of Rumford, tells about when he and his father first walked into the Enniscoggin Valley. The trees were tall as a ship's mast from the edge of the water to the foot of the hills. So they had to get rid of the. There were really no use for the lumber. They had to clear the land in order to raise their crops. The stumps they could pull and make fences. And you see the remnants sometimes of stump fences nowadays. Well, it goes on up until, we'll have to skip around, in 1840. And I want to read you a little list from the 1840 census when the government law required all farmers to make a census of the crops that they raised in that particular year. On the farm where the ordinary people, townspeople, recognize the wild animal park on Route 2 below Rumford Point, this was a list of crops that came off that farm that year. 15 bushels of corn, 35 pounds of clover seed. A clover seed was a cash crop. They didn't need all that, but this was all that clover. But this was a great place to raise clover, and it could be sold in other places. And so they could raise clover and thrash it by treading the oxen over it and turn it into cash. Wheat, 55 bushels of wheat and 40 bushels of rye. Wheat was a staple item in those days because they could take it to the grist mills and grind their flour. 150 bushels of oats, which were used for livestock feed. A bushel and a half of beans, a bushel of peas, 500 bushels of potatoes. They raised a lot of potatoes because they could take them to the starch mills And about that time, they were, the starch mills were paying them 15 cents a bushel. Half a bushel of flax seed, 3 bushels of turnip, 2 bushels of onions, 25 pounds of flax, 20 yards of linen cloth manufactured, 50 pounds of wool, and 18 tons of hay. That was typical of that time. And if you go through that whole census list, you'll find just about the same amount raised on every 100 or 200 acre farm.
So this was the Kimball Martin farm.
That's right. That's right, at that time. He settled there first. Another place that they settled was Red Hill, and it was early up there. In fact, there were squatters up there that never got title to the lands. And it was the Harper brothers, two that came here from Freiburg, that named the hill. They named it because the two Harper brothers had red hair.
Oh.
And that's how Red Hill got its name. That's why a lot of people have hunted up there and crossed the land, and they found many cellar holes that didn't match up with the deeds. But they were squatters, and there were squatters in other places we find too. They came here, they lived a few years, they dug a cellar and rocked it up. And then when somebody bought the lands, they were kicked out and they moved on somewhere else, sort of gypsy-like. The agriculture moved on quite fast. The dairy herds become increasingly popular, and there came a time what to do with all of the milk, the cream, mostly cream. So what happens here, we have the formation in about 1887 of the Rumford Dairying Association. They established a creamery, sometimes called a butter factory. And it was at Rumford Center. And there they sold stock. And the people, they didn't take the milk there, they took the cream there. They didn't bother, they fed the milk, they separated it through the rising process, fed the skim milk to the pigs and took the cream to the factory, and it was a cash crop. That eventually, of course, went into the Turner Center system, and now you know what it's like today. But this was quite a prosperous association. The building itself, after it ceased to be used for that purpose, was bought by a man by the name of Cyrus Eaton and turned into a carriage shop. He was a carriage maker. And of course, the tragic fire in 1921, the thing burned up. The farm buildings were typical New England. Here we have three different buildings, probably in the 1840s or 1850s, all connected. And if you look at the styling, you take a look at them, they're scattered around. This one and this one are no longer standing, this one is. But those were probably the work of David Elliott. They all had a style that was used by him, and he was known as a housewright. Now you see, they use these titles in transferring property. You find them in the register deeds. David Elliott, housewright, deeds such and such to so and so. Now a housewright was an accorded title. You find also the word joiner in some instances. But a joiner was a man that finished off the inside of the houses, the cabinets and so forth. And so...
Housewright is a new term to me.
Well, that's... Housewright was used in those early years. And as I say, each housewright or builder had a title of his own. Potatoes, corn, and one of the big things in the early years was the raising of hops. And there were, here we have some slides of hop picking. This was on the silver farm at North Rumford. Hops were a good cash crop. They went into the dry houses, were dried and sent on to the factories, probably for mostly making beer, but they did use them for medicinal purposes somewhat. And they were hop pillows. They were made into pillows a lot for the scent. It's supposed to have a sedating effect upon a person. Also, the corn was a big crop, and we get into the canning corn process later. But here is a typical corn field around the turn of the century, Bud.
Was there a corn factory or canning?
Yeah, right here, right. With several of them around here. I'm coming to that in a few minutes. And here we see a picture of potatoes, probably the last of the picking by hand and putting into the barrels and then loaded into the trucks and carried to the houses. Now it's all combined. But that was the progress of farming through the, it was quite rugged 200 years ago, and it's quite scientific at this time. One of the things that the settlers encountered was the river. It was beneficial to the town because it provided great great tillage land and so forth. But there were a lot of hazards because to cross it was a large stream, and they had to have a system of ferries and bridges and so forth. Probably the first system was the ferries, and there were several ferries over the river, all up and down it. I think from the New Hampshire line until you reached down around Jay Canton, the near as I can tell were around 15 different ferries at various times. And probably one of the earliest ones was here at the Rumford Point. That was started, somewhere around 1800 by a man named James Harper. But James Harper didn't have a ferry as we knew them. Apparently it was it was large enough so he could take a horse and a wagon, but he pulled it across the river, didn't have the cable. And then the cable ferries come in around 1808 or 1809, and here you see a ferry being propelled across. We use this one especially because they could propel the boat across by setting the angle of the boat, and the current was used as a propellant to push the thing across. And when they wanted to go the other way, they just reversed the position of the boat and they carried it on, and here is one of the same ferry that shows the masts on each side. It doesn't show the ratchet effect there, but they had to have a ratchet there to pull that cable up, which incidentally was rope instead of cable.
It was rope.
In early years, it was hemp rope, but before cable was invented, I guess, available at this area. At Hanover, there was a ferry for many, many years. And in fact, one time, I think it was in the 1927 flood, the ferry, the boat broke loose, and a group of us caught it in back of the village here at the point and hitched it to the trees. And when the water went down, we took the outboard motors and pushed it back up to Hanover. But here in this one, you can see in particular, the teams of horses, they weren't worried too much about horses jumping off the front, but they were afraid of backing off, so they put the barrier up in back of the horses. And that had that from one of Hanover shows that. Now here's one of Rumford Center, which was just the same type. The thing, the last ferry left the Androscoggin in 1956 when the bridge was built here at the point. It was dragged out of the river and loaded onto a flatbed and hauled down onto the coast somewhere, and this is the departure of the last ferry on the Androscoggin. But it's interesting, it to the point where the ferryman had to be licensed by the county commissioners, and the fees were set by the county commissioners. And here we have a set of fees as approved in 1874. You know, it cost 2 cents for a foot passenger across, but a horse and rider 5 cents, but if you had a carriage, cost you 6 cents. It's well, the ferries ended anyway, and the bridges came in. And there were many of them. And one of the few people realize it, but Rumford did have 2 covered bridges at one time. Excuse me. Here's a scene of the covered bridge over the Ellis River. And
now this is where the present one stands?
That's right. And here is the Porter Bridge, so-called, over the Swift River. This went out in an unusual, what they called an ice tornado. It's written up in the newspapers. It's some sort of blew it about 50 feet upstream. It was a real typical covered bridge with a wooden arch and everything. And it went out, and as I say, on the 24th of November, 1900. Previously, there'd been a bridge at Hale above there. That was last, I believe, around 1870. After the Porter Bridge left, they had the Rumford in Mexico were getting pretty well popularized, and they built what they called the Red Bridge between Rumford and Mexico. It's where the present bridge is now, but it was painted red, and everybody knew it as the Red Bridge.
Right down by the mouth of the street.
That's right, where the present bridge is there now. There was a Dixfield Peru toll bridge. The photo here shows it in operation in 1895 with the toll taker standing out there ready to take the nickel for crossing. And at North Rumford was what they called the Iron Bridge. And it's unusual that you can catch 2 bridges in the same picture, the modern and the old, but here it is. This was about 1890 when the Iron Bridge was established. About 20 years ago, the present bridge was built.
I remember that.
And it was a real change there, because before the Iron Bridge, there was no bridge there at all. They had to ford the river across on the ice in the wintertime. Of course, the first bridge was here at the point in built in 1815. I thought I had a picture of it here somewhere. I fact, I do. It went out in 1839 in the flood. Bingo. It left. And it wasn't rebuilt until 1954. There were battles over the years about the bridge, but it finally, and there's a picture of it as you know it today.
Is this the one you were instrumental in getting?
That's right. Now here where the Moss Bridge, so-called Moss Bridge, in Rumford, there was another iron bridge that shows looking across the island toward Moss's Mill, which was the popular grain mill there at the time. It was a toll bridge that went out in the 36 flood. It later changed into a free bridge, but it originally was a toll bridge. They called it the Ridlandville Bridge, where the present footbridge is left. That was a toll bridge. And of course, here's the old original bridge that went out in the flood of 1936. Yet we have a lot of reminders of the old times here. It was, they had notions of steamboating on the Enniscorgen early. And one of the first ones that ventured into it was Hiram Ricker. Hiram Ricker had married the daughter of Bolster. Yes, forget the name here. Who was in business at East Rumford, had a general store, a country store, and an inn. Jeanette Bolster became his wife. And in fact, he lived here a while. But in 1854, he devised a scheme of water travel from Rumford to Canton, because the railroad was coming in, and this would provide a connection in the growing Rumford. Here is a copy of the records that appeared in a book that's in Sturbridge, Connecticut now, of the building of that boat. He named it the Surprise. The boat never acted as it should have. In other words, it was a side wheeler, and that was probably the mistake. It was a considerable, it was about, they say, around 50 to 55 feet long, and it was patterned after the Mississippi River boats. But it could not contend with the currents in the river. In the first trip up from Canton, it capsized when what they called at that time Lunce Island. And it never reached its destination. It was taken back to Canton, and apparently there are stories that it might have been, the engine might have been used for a sawmill, but at any rate, the boat just disappeared. Now, there was no other person tried it until James Elliott lived at Rumford Corner, had a little shop there, and he built a boat, and he called it the Pioneer. It was a smaller boat, and we don't have a picture of it, but we have one that's similar. That was used up on the McGalloway River and Umbagog Lake. And you'll see this in there, but it's a smaller boat. It could carry about a dozen or 15 persons. That boat made many trips. There is one story that it went to, the newspaper story, that went to Andover on one time. But a lot of people questioned it because people that travel that river, canoe it and so forth, and are familiar with it, don't believe that a boat could ever go into that size,
especially
could ever get to into it. That's right.
You see the horse there being, or is that a cow?
Well, they carried, they claim it would carry up to 20 passengers. But what happened one morning, Sunday morning, they were steaming it up on the Rumford Corner side of the river to take it for an excursion. And the boat caught fire and burned and sank. And as far as anybody knows, the engine still remains in the mud in the bottom of that river today. A little after that, the North Star in Hanover came into being. A boat company was formed, J.B. Roberts and a lot of prominent businessmen had formed the Enskogan Boat Company and built this boat. And there are some sort of dimensions of it given here. 47 feet long by a 10-foot beam with a 24 horsepower motor, of course, with wood fired. And in the 1893 July edition of the Times, it says the North Star made its first trip down the river on the 4th, about 50 were aboard. On coming back, it ran into one of the old bridge piers and made quite a commotion. But through the kindness of Mr. Knight, the ferryman, the crew were carried on to his boat, and the steam was soon pulled off and steaming up the river. So that ended the steamboat area in Rumford. As I say, we had a lot of bridges. Here is an unusual photo, which it's not an ancient piece, but it is a photograph from ground level of the Memorial Bridge.
Carpenter's dream.
Yeah, that's right. Also, we had the floods and the fires along the Enskogan River, and there were many. The fires were spotty, but most of them occurred in the early part of the 20th century. But on the floods, of course, the earliest one was 1785, when the water rose 25 feet above the normal level. They know the mark in Bethel on a building, which was taken by Dr. True, who wrote much of the early history of Bethel. And incidentally, that occurred in October. Now, all of the big floods on the river do not necessarily appear in the springtime, because in 1839, the one that took the Point Bridge out was in the middle of the year. In 1857, the Ellis River Bridge went out. In October 1869 was the Great Pumpkin Freshet, so-called. In April 1895, there are pictures in the album, the historic albums, that show water going over the falls in huge waves and so forth. In November 1927, the one that almost took out the footbridge in Rumford, that's the time that the town manager, Gray, almost got washed into the river trying to sandbag the foot of the island. In 1936, of course, was the greatest flood since 1785. And we have numerous photos in the booklet that were prepared by the Rumford Times all through the area. And of course, then we had the 1987 flood. We have pictures here of the Virginia section in the 36 flood. a photograph of Rumford Center in the 36 flood, the Rumford Point Ferry House. There are all sorts of pictures here which show you the preponderance of the water, the ice, and everything that kept coming down the stream and damaging. In fact, the 36 flood was almost a week long. It had two rises. The ice went out, and the damage caused, it receded a bit, and then 36 flood, it appeared again. Of course, one of the greatest fires in Rumford was the Waldo Street fire in 1923. It wiped out practically half of Waldo Street, and not too many photographs available. That was probably the one. This is a copy. And then again, in 1941, Hanover had a great fire. That was the time of the fire in the western part of the county, the forest fires. At one time there, the half, 50% of the houses in Hanover were on fire. The dry shingle roofs and so forth, many people lost their homes. It was a terrible time for the Hanover people. And in fact, in 1954 or 56, the Rumford Falls Times buildings burned, and all of the machinery, and that was the last time that the Times was ever printed in Rumford. And they got a charter for that one. That is about the time that the electric railroad was becoming quite popular. In fact, Everett K. Day had come here and established the E.K. Day Company. That had been his job as a set them up earlier. He just set them up between Augusta and Holland before he came here. Well, the survey for that one went, come up, followed the river up Rumford Center, went up the end of the road to what we call Whirlpool, down Whirlpool, and then back to the river. And nobody really knows just why they made that loop, whether to get near Andover, or whether to avoid the hill, the grade down by between Rumford Point and Rumford Center. Anyway, it failed. The charter was granted, but they never raised the money. And probably it was because whether the automobile nobody wanted to. Nobody wanted to fool with it. Stagecoach had several different types. There was one, when they didn't have too much of a load, there was a three-horse stagecoach line. But the Tuttle brothers had two genuine Concord coaches, and one of them burned when the barn of the building burned in Rumford Corner, which was called Rumford at that time. But this here is taken from a book of the Concord coaches. And this was the coach that ran the team here, Brian Pond and Andover. Here we have a picture of an automobile that was made here in Rumford. Made by Tom Frank.